Welcome to the Sunset Safari. We are here in the position of Karula's little beauties, and right in the center of frame there's actually a leopard cub. We are going to move shortly so we can get a bit of visual, but while we're around the cubs, only one vehicle moving at a time. So there we go, you can see a little bit of movement. So there we go, your hand's finished moving. I'm Brent and I have Brian on camera with me today. And sometimes we're known as the killer bees. Brian also has a special friend with him today. It's the thumb who actually controls the camera. So we're going to move now. Out in the other vehicle is James and Dangerous Dave the Dish. And on foot, Jean-Ray, Jamie and Herb. So we're going to move now very carefully, very slowly. Mom's not here. So we've only had visual of one cub so far. I've got some really exciting news, but I think I'm going to keep it in my pocket for a little bit longer. Brian, you tell me if you get a nice gap through the spike thorns. Oh, there we go. Say when, Brian? So I'm pretty sure the others around, I can't see whether this is the male or female just yet. There you go, center frame. Waiting patiently for Mom to return. Now we're going to be sitting here for quite a while this evening, so I'm quite sure the other might make its presence known a little bit later. Mentioned on this morning's sunrise safari, I went through to the head rangers meeting today and there was much discussion of cubs. So I'm just going to give you guys a quick cub update on what's going on. And throughout the whole northern Sabi Sands, the Styx cubs are still well and seen regularly to the south. There's, if I remember correctly, 8 of them. And of course, the Inkahuma, we now think there is definitely 6, but there could be as many as 9 Inkahuma cubs. We know there's 3 different litters at the moment. And of course, and Shadow and her cub.
Well, there you are, everybody. What a brilliant start. 2 tiny little leopard cubs. Well, they've been renamed now, and I don't know how I feel about that. Well, I do, actually. I feel dreadfully depressed about it. We are in the process of trying to get into that lion sighting that we had this morning, the one where the Inkahumas killed the buffalo, and we had beautiful cub sighting today. There are 2 impala over there. We've just gone past some elephants, and I'm not going to stop. We're going to quickly try and get in there just to see if the cubs are still there, because we know that there are many, many game drives going to be mobile this afternoon. We go out a little bit before everyone else. Now, I'm going to stop briefly here. Davey, if you can just show everybody the vultures coming flying in here. There are hundreds of them. Look at them all. Can you see them, Dave?
Yep.
Look at them, and they're all coming down. And this is a big lesson, because of course when we see vultures in the sky, often we think, well, there must be something dead there. Half the time they've just seen a thermal and they're all going to the thermal to share it, to go up into the sky. But if you watch these ones, they're all coming down. They're starting to descend. It's wonderful. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There aren't quite hundreds, but there are a lot. Mostly white-backed vultures, and they'll all be coming in. All right, let's go a little bit closer. Like I say, there are going to be quite a few people coming in here, I imagine, during the course of the afternoon. So I just want to quickly get the lay of the land. It was said that apparently the lions and the cubs moved away from the carcass because they were set upon by a number of hyenas. I think everyone's safe, and they went off north, but they could have come back again. So I think it's worth just having a quick look. There are no lions there, then we'll probably move out and go and see what else we can find. We did find some elephants on the way here, which is quite nice, but I just thought we better come and look here before everybody gets mobile, and we'll have a look at the wild chas and of course what remains of that hapless buffalo bull, which was unceremoniously removed from this life by the lions yesterday. Five lionesses killed a big buffalo bull. That's no mean feat. Right, hold on tight, everyone. I'm going to have to give a little bit of a speed round here. Well done, David. You survived. Now, I think the vultures are already on this carcass. You know, I'm going to approach very slowly. I see not lion. I see not hyena. I see and smell rotting buffalo. Do you smell rotting buffalo, David? It is not a pleasant smell, is it? Mm-mm. Now, what's interesting here is that the buffalo carcass is here, but there are no vultures on it, no hyenas, which says to me that one of those two major predators is still around here somewhere. Let's just ease our way down here and switch off and have a listen. There is the buffalo. Fear not, it feels no longer any pain. It is quite dead. That is its stomach, which you can see in front of it, that sort of brownish, disgusting-looking thing. Much of the stomach contents, of course, to the left of that. And, of course, the behind that. Now, there is a lot of meat left there, and these vultures will be strongly considering coming down. But I don't understand why they aren't down here already. I didn't see a whole lot of them fly off when we got here. And so it might be that there is a hyena or a lioness around here somewhere. You got a vulture? Oh yes, marvellous. Look at that, that's a hooded vulture. Alright, we're going to look around here and see if we can find the lions. While we do that, let's go across to Jamie. She is on her little feet today.
Hello guys, and welcome to the Sunset Safari. My name is Jamie, and obviously I am on foot, and I have Jandre on camera with me, and of course the ever-present Herbert, who is walking ahead of us and making sure that everything is safe and secure. So this afternoon we're going to head out, and we're actually going to try and help everybody find Karula, the Queen of Juma. And we're going to head straight back to where we left her when we were on the vehicle on the Sunrise Safari, and we're going to see if we can't spot her around there. She was definitely hunting. Let's go and find out if she has had any success. Before we do that, they were watching us while we were busy talking. In that termite mound, I wonder, I think we're a little bit close to get their heads poking up if we're looking at them. But in that termite mound is a dwarf mongoose that has been watching us walk across quarantine clearings. The nice thing about this particular group on quarantine is they actually have got really, really used to the different people moving about in this area. So there's groups of dwarf mongoose that are terrified of people, and then there are groups of dwarf mongoose that are relatively relaxed. However, because we're about, I would say, about 15 feet away from this termite mound, he's feeling a little bit scared, and I don't think he's quite ready to pop out. Sometimes that works. No, I don't think so, especially not with the great hulking figure of Jandre behind me. But before we set out, here's something that we don't often look at, just because we're often so focused on other things on bushwalk and on the vehicles that for those of you building up your tracking scrapbooks, we forget to highlight these things. And I think you might be able to see this whole section here really nice and clearly. So a lot of our viewers put together scrapbooks of tracks or screenshots of tracks to get an idea of what the different animals leave behind. Now this, I'm not even going to quiz you on. If you don't get this particular patch very easily, well, this, for most of you, you'll know almost immediately that it is a blue wildebeest midden. and a male blue wildebeest at that, and I'll tell you why. First of all, because they're the ones that have the middens, and second of all, because we can actually see the tracks in here. So this is the hoof print of the wildebeest here. One half there, one half there, and then of course his dung absolutely everywhere, which is a midden. A midden is a place where an animal goes and defecates regularly. Well, the reason we know that it is a male wildebeest and not a female is, apart from behavior, he has been scraping his hoof in the soil to put the scent of his sort of interdigital gland or his pedal gland onto his territory. And what that's done is it's actually smoothed out the top part of his back track. So instead of having a nice sharp track in the way that females do, male wildebeest actually scrape away and round out their tracks. We're going to carry on, follow Herbert into the bush and go and see if we can't get to Karula before we run out of light. While we do that, let's go back to Brent and find out how his afternoon is going.
Well, my afternoon's always spectacular when spent in the presence of little leopards. And there we go, that's the second cub on the other side of the termitaria. Now, from these visuals, it's very difficult to determine who's who in the zoo. And as I was saying, I'll just carry on with the cub update I was giving. Very exciting news. Tundi has given birth. We're not sure how many cubs yet, but they're underneath the Chitwa Chitwa room 9 deck. So that area has been zoned for now. And probably about a week old. She's been in and out of there for a week. I just put my handbrake on. And, okay, what cubs? We did the sticks. We did the Nkumas. We've done Karula. Done Tundi. Done Shadow. Ah, in Kanyeni. I think that only the female cub is surviving. She's been seen 4 times now with only a single cub. That's quite sad, but it is nature. And that does what happens out here in the African bush. And now the more exciting news is we put forward some names for Queen Karula's cubs. And the names have been accepted by all the head rangers. That was one of the most important things I went to do at the rangers meeting today. So for the first time, they shall no longer be known as George and Charlotte. Those names are gone. We're going to go with some beautiful Shangaan names. The female cub will be known as Shongile, which means exquisitely beautiful. And I think that is an absolutely perfect name for that little female. And the little male will be known as Hosana. And that means little prince or little chief. So Shongile and Hosana. Isn't that amazing? So there we go. We no longer have to refer to them by a cub or by George and Charlotte. They shall now be known as Shongile and Hosana. So very exciting stuff. And it is a little bit young to name compared to normal traditions, but we've all discussed this in the head rangers meeting, and we're going to name the cubs from now. And those names will stick if they survive beyond a year. We're not going to have different names for them anymore. So there we go. Very exciting. Now let's have a look at either Shongile or Hosana. I'm hoping the other cub, which is over there on the other side of the termite mound, comes down to join. A little tail flicking. And it's nice and warm, 23 degrees Celsius, 70 odd Fahrenheit. So that's why they're in the shade, patiently awaiting mother's return. And fingers crossed, Karula's had a successful day hunting and she's going to lead them off to a nice big meal. Oh, it is really quiet. There's almost not a sound in the bush at the moment. I can hear a fly buzzing. Yeah, I can actually see the fly buzzing. It's buzzing around my face. can you even hear one cricket? It's sort of that warm time of the afternoon. Even the birds seem to be very, very still. A slight breeze and that really distinctive winter sort of smell that you get in the bush, it's sort of dust. Hi, Monique. Monique's in London. And Monique would like to know, is it not risky to view the cubs without their mother? Not at this stage. They're about 5 months old now. They're quite alert and they're capable of climbing trees. And a lot of these decisions are made purely on where they are. So if they happen to be really in a very thick, tight drainage line where you have to drive very close to get a view, and then we probably wouldn't view them. But they're sitting on top of a nice big termite mound. They've got a commanding sort of view of all around. Oh, up. Did it hear Mom? Wouldn't that be spectacular to see Karula coming back to greet her little cubbies? So is he? No, I'm trying to get comfortable again. Oh, tired kitty. There it is. I don't know if you guys can see, is that the male or is that the female? If you can see, let me know. Questions at wildearth.tv, hashtag safari live. Now, as I was saying, Monique, in this situation, they're in a really relatively safe area. They've got lots of different escape avenues, and it doesn't require bundu bashing to get to them. So, and also, the vehicles are going to be quite static because the cubs are not moving from that termite mound. So it is perfectly okay to view them at the moment. And again, these type of decisions need to be made depending on the circumstance. Sorry, I just got to be on the radio with Johan. Johan, there's one right on top. And then there's a second one that's popped out on the back side. So we can't see the second one. We just caught bits of movement through the thickets up to the right of the one we're seeing. There we go. Brian's going to show you where. A little bit higher. So right in that thick, thick stuff. We just saw the movement a little while ago. We're going to sit here and patiently wait to see what happens, and hopefully Karula comes back and leads them to a kill. While we do that, James has got the biggest of the great grey land animals to show you.
As opposed to the smallest of the great grey animals, which would of course be a common duiker. Indeed, it might be a rather old bushveld gerbil that was greying. This an elephant, and this cow is not happy. She's been watching us very carefully. We haven't been here long, but we did drive past the herd on our way to try and find those elephants, at least those lions. Those are the tawny things with the long tails, Dave. I didn't even introduce myself. My name is James. Dave is on camera. Hello, David, again.
Hello.
Yes, wonderful to have you with me. And as we drove past them earlier, she just came and she gave us a bit of a head shake. And this is a good opportunity to now, if you are unclear about elephant behavior, it's a good opportunity to see an elephant that is not particularly comfortable. Now, you can't really see it here, but what she's doing is she's feeding okay now, but she does keep turning her trunk towards us to smell, and she keeps her eye on us, and she keeps listening to us, and she keeps her calf the other side of her. You can see just underneath her there, a little calf of probably 18 months or 2 years or so. It's been suckling, and she's keeping that little calf that side of her, in other words, between her and us, at least keeping herself between the calf and us. And then I think she's the matriarch of this little herd. It's probably about 8 or 10 elephants. And she gave them a quite stern order when we came up closer earlier on. And they moved off quite smartly. Now, I don't know where those lions went. I'm afraid we didn't manage to find them. We didn't find any hyenas either. And I suspect that they've gone towards One-Eyed Pan, which is a piece of pumped water not too far from here, but where we aren't allowed to go, alas and alack. And that's on Simbambili. So we'll just enjoy these elephants for a little while. Then I think we might zoop across to Cheetah Plains and see what's on offer there, now that Brent has got the cubbies. And if he sits there long enough, I've no doubt their mum will return and, given her skills, probably lead them off to some hapless antelope that she's managed to take care of, to dispatch during the course of the day. You now know their new names, of course. And as I said to you this morning, you know, I was the first to say that I wasn't really concerned what they were called. You know, they're leopards, they don't mind what they're called. I now find myself, of course, completely contradicting that. Rather sad that George and Charlotte will no longer be their names. David, do you feel profoundly saddened by this news? Yes, less so. Slightly sad, yes. Yes, good. Still, we still have Zara. Let's move a little bit forward. It's quite thick woodland here. Here's a youngish bull on the left-hand side that we'll just have a stop next to. A little bit more confiding. Well, not that much more. Also trying to keep himself between, or kind of keep some woodland between us and him. A little bit nervous, and I don't know if you can see, you can't really see him there, but he's twitching his trunk towards us just to see what we smell like. And all we smell like now is burning gasoline. Not even the conditioner that keeps David's fine locks in their resplendent curls is able to overcome the smell of gasoline. There we go, lovely picture of gold and copper and green and grey. Right. I'm laughing because I've just been asked to link to Jamie on Bushwalk. And the reason we're linking to her is because she has a cocoon thing. Enjoy the cocoon thing, everyone.
A cocoon thing indeed. And have a look at the cocoon thing, which is just visible in between the various spikes of this particular bush. Very, very difficult for us to see, but here it is. And it's a fascinatingly shaped cocoon thing. It is in fact the cocoon of a bagworm. Now, bagworm is one of those incredible little caterpillar type worms that collects a whole mound of rubbish, leaves and bits of hair and whatever it can find, onto its back, and it carries it around. It looks like a little walking pile of debris, and you wouldn't know that it was a living creature until it actually moves across the ground. And what we have here is its casing, its cocoon, for it to pupate, dangling very gently off the edge of a bush that is not terribly palatable to the animals around here. And what we've recently found out is that this is incredibly toxic to livestock. So local people make sure that they remove it from the areas where they keep their cattle, if they ever happen to find it, if they see it beforehand. Because apparently what happens is it's very, very toxic, and the livestock actually end up dying as a result of ingesting it. Now, apparently this has been tested and proven to be the case. Usually when you've got livestock dying, if they've died and there's no clear reason what it might be, almost invariably out here, one of the biggest reasons is that it's going to be caused by a snake bite. But it's usually quite easy to find the puncture wounds of the snake bite itself. The alternative is that the livestock have eaten something toxic, whether it's a bulb or some kind of root system, root structure, perhaps it's just a plant that they are not evolved to deal with. One of those things might be an accidental ingestion of a bagworm's cocoon thingy. It's, I think, the best description I've heard in a while. On this very warm afternoon, it's definitely warmer than I was expecting, and I regret my lack of shorts. I definitely feel as though I've been unprepared for this particular temperature, so we're going to carry on. We're going to keep moving quickly as possible so that we don't lose light while we do. Back to James and his elephant thingies.
That, everybody, is clearly an elephant bull. You can see that, of course, from the fact that his back is slightly rounder than the female's. He's also got a rounder forehead than theirs, and his tusks are a bit thicker at the base. Did you see that, David?
Yes, yes.
You see how obviously he was a bull. Very good. Now, we've just haven't quite left Arethusa yet, because there's this little elephant herd here, and this bull is very clearly, well, I think he's got quite amorous intentions. And we heard some squealing elephants around here. I thought it might be the lions that they were sort of trying to chase, but there you can see very clearly that he is testing the female to see if she might be ready to mate with him. He's too small to be mating now. He's sort of trying his luck. He's like a teenage boy at the school social. And she is going to reject him out of hand, I suspect. He's only about 18 years old or so. And 25 is around about the age that they normally could expect to mate for the first time. But if there was a big sort of 45-year-old, 35-year-old bull around here, he'd be skedaddling through the bushes trying to avoid them. And interestingly, you can see there the female, that's the one on the far left-hand side, has got a calf. That little calf is hers. And so they are breeding active far earlier than the bulls are. Beautiful. And I think he may have caught himself on a thorn there and put away his equipment. Okay. I'm just going to go forward here, and we're going to turn around at that very large leadwood stump, or it's not really a stump so much as a skeleton, is it, David? We're going to turn around there, and then we'll go back out of Arethusa. We're on the Simbambili cut line. I'm pretty sure the lions cross north. There are elephants everywhere. There's another one over there. All right, let's go back to Brent and the leopard cubs while I decide what to do here.
So not much has changed here. Just a sleepy kitty. And we still haven't seen the other one again after the initial movement. Even though it is relatively cool by African standards, if you're out in the sun, it is quite warm. But we are just incredibly lucky and privileged to spend this much time with the little guys. I could sit here for days. I don't know about you, Brian. So try and see if we can find another little gap somewhere, and we can see a little bit more. Try to sneak our nose into this little gap ahead of us. Watch the tamuti, Brian. Be careful. Can you see any more from there, Brian? Brian's still fighting the tree, we apologize. Oh, watch out for the milky latex. Don't want to get that dripping on you. No good for Brian. Okay, well, it's worth a try. How's that? I'll have a quick look. No. Now, this morning, the cub was lying out in that glorious sunshine on the other side of the termite mound, but now that it's hot, hiding in the shade. Now, I'm hoping Mom is on her way back. Lead them off to a meal. Well, Ashley is hoping the same as me that Karula has caught some breakfast or dinner or any time snack for the little cubs. Now, it is worth playing the patience game here, especially as it gets a bit cooler. They're probably going to move around to the western side of the termite mound, where it's going to be a bit warmer and it can bask in the afternoon sun. What do you think, Brian, if we might try on that side of the marula tree? I think we might get a better window than we've got here. It's always important to just move very slowly, even though Karula's cubs are quite relaxed and used to the vehicles. It's always better to just keep that very slow movement around cubs, especially when their mom's not here. So you see, we're just everything very slowly. Look down. It's an ideal sort of area to leave cubs in. You see, there's lots of big trees around that if they had to, they could scramble up to get away from potential predators. Let's see if we could get a little gap through here. Waiting to see what happens. Now there's also, I noticed, a hole in this termite mound. You can see there, where I'm trying to see, so there's quite a lot of bright sun today. There, it's a little hole on the termite mound, so they could even go into the ground if they had to get away from a potential predator. It does look like that hole has been utilized by a warthog at some point. I think it's probably wise for the warthog not to spend too much time here at the moment. Remember, we're on a live African safari with tiny little leopard cubs, about 5 months old, and they have now been named. Look, you can see, I can see shadows moving, which means the cub is moving. Could be trying to come up to the top now. And so remember, they've been named now Hosanna and Shongile are the names of the little cubs. And remember, Shongile means exquisitely beautiful, and Hosanna means little chief or little prince. Oh, there we go. Okay, I'm just going to move. So while we reposition to get you a better view of these little guys, James has got the tallest of tall creatures.
The biggest, the tallest, there it is, the tallest, the giraffe, a male giraffe. And I'm constantly struck every time I see a bull giraffe here that they are always slightly different colors. This fellow, much greater gaps between his markings, much thinner horns, but quite a pointy, pronounced median horn, if you like, that sort of calcification of the skull. Looks not unlike, he's sort of a unicorn version. You see that, David? He's like the unicorn version of the giraffe. Now, you see the black tongue there, Dave? Can you get in on the black tongue? That black tongue, everybody, I read the other day, is actually a function of the fact that it spends quite a lot of time in the sun, and therefore it has a lot of melanin on it. If you were to sort of get climb a tree, and as the giraffe came towards the tree, grab its tongue and pull it all the way out, what you'd find is that the bit behind that you can see is black, but if you gave it a little bit of a tug, you'd find that it was pink behind that. And that's because it doesn't have to be exposed to the sun, and so therefore it's sorry, the game drive radio again, ballistic in my ear. So it's pink at the back, dark on the front, because the back is obviously never exposed to the sun, unless of course you happen to give it a tug while sitting in the tree from which the giraffe is eating. That particular scenario, unlikely to be an eventuality. Now, Louise, do you really want to go to the leopard cubs now? Are you sure you want to go to the leopard cubs? Because, in fact, let's go to the leopard cubs. There are some elephants, but they're quite far from here. So let's go to those leopards.
There we go. And it's moved to the top of the termite mound. So a bit of a much better view for us. And I think the other little leopard has moved off into the river system behind. I can hear a squirrel alarm calling around where that big tree is. Sorry guys, it's got to be on the game drive radio for a second. Tax, were you looking for me? She knows. Look, little leopards often get very bored when their mom leaves them alone for long periods of time, but during the heat they generally keep quite still, and it's only really maybe a little bit later in the evening that they might play, so we might get to see them play. And there are some other vehicles who are going to be interested in coming here, and we will give them a chance and then possibly come back a little later. There we go. Heading back down to the shade, it got a bit hot. There we go. But now, if Brian goes off to the behind us, where I can hear that squirrel alarm calling. So you see that? Zoom in there, Brian. So a little, there we go, around that big green scotia tree. I think, or actually a little bit close than that, but I think that the female or the other cub might be in the tree there. So let's go have a look. Okay, so while we keep checking, Jamie's got an eight-legged predator to show you.
I have an eight-legged thief to show you in this particular case, a cleptoparasite called a dewdrop spider. And it looks exactly like somebody put a little drop of mercury, or perhaps a drop of molten silver, on a spider web and then gave it some legs. And it's my absolute, I think it might even be my favorite spider. And you find them in webs of all kinds of things, from tent spiders to orb spiders to the funnel web spiders. You get these little dewdrop parasites, cleptoparasites. And they're very, very tiny. I don't know why they're silver. I would love to know why they've taken on such a bright luminescent coloring. I have no idea what it, because you'd think that a kleptoparasite, you'd think that something that thieves for a living, so to speak, would try and be as camouflaged and as secretive as possible. But basically these guys just hang around the edge, trying to attract little attention to themselves before moving in and stealing whatever remnants of the kill they happen to find. And these buffalo thorn trees, like the ones that we are on here, you can see the main host spider, who is dangling with the bundle of debris collected in the web, as well as what actually look like. They look like there might be egg casings in there as well. A tent spider with a kleptoparasite. And there's actually a couple of them, but you have to get them at exactly the right angle to get the shine that they exhibit. So Jamie's definitely in Jamie's top five favorite spiders. And then, if we go down just a little bit, we've got the remnants of a waxbill nest, a blue waxbill nest. And if you think about it, if you're a little bird, this is the perfect spot to hide a nest site. I mean, for me, I was going to show you something, but I kind of proved my point. Thank you, Herbert. Herbert's managed to untangle me from the buffalo thorn that I was trapped in. But it kind of proves my point, because getting yourself in here, if you're a predator, is, first of all, you've got to spot something that basically looks like a bundle of gathered up grass seeds and not much else. And then you've got to try and navigate through these incredibly sharp thorns. It's basically like running a gauntlet. And the adults do it relatively well. They can sneak through agile little birds, ducking their way in to get through to feed the chicks themselves. And it doesn't always work out exactly the way that they think it might. Now, those of you who were watching our special, or our build-up to the special Father's Day broadcasts in the States, you might have seen that bird that was impaled, baby bird that was impaled upon a buffalo thorn. And that was probably a blue waxbill. In fact, it was definitely a blue waxbill chick that unfortunately attempted, either fell out of the nest or attempted to move out of the nest and got itself caught on any one of these incredibly sharp thorns. Even as Jandre is navigating around the buffalo thorn, he's doing so with great care, so as not to find himself hooked in a tree many of you will by now know as a wachabiki tree, or a wait a little, the buffalo thorn, because if you just so much as look at it wrong, it manages to somehow hook a piece of skin and attach itself there. A really, really, truly amazing tree, and an amazing little technique that the blue waxbill has in terms of hiding their nests. We're going to carry on. I don't want to waste too much light. We're nearly at where we left Karula. This is a zebra wood, by the way. Sorry, since I'm clutching it, and it must look utterly bizarre. This is a zebra wood with its incredibly solid thorns. There's no other tree in the world that has thorns coming from thorns that are as solid as this tree does. definitely an instant flat tire if you happen to find one and drive over it. Right, we're going to continue on over to James and his wildebeest herd.
We found the Great Migration, everybody, and it is just moving north onto Biffle's Hook. And I think it's rather splendid. We haven't seen these wildebeest for a long time. And I don't know where they've been, but I suspect quite strongly that they've been down on the Sand River, drinking the pools of water that there are left there, perhaps even as far south as the Sabi River. But this is, I think, our herd that we saw burgeoning in size during the course of the lambing season, or calving season in the case of wildebeest, earlier this year. Not earlier this year at all. Later last year, sort of around November. That's a yearling there that you're looking at there. Not quite a yearling. What would it be? It'd be about an 8 or 9 month old wildebeest. That is headbutting some other wildebeest on the backside. Wonderful. So this herd has got a lot bigger. It was only probably 10 of them to start with. I think many of the females had calves. We had 11. In fact, we had 11 calves. I remember that. I think one of them bit it. But the rest of them seemed to have survived. So this herd is now at least sort of 25 strong as they head off there into the woodland. And that's really nice. And you obviously, most of you will know that the blue wildebeest, which is what this is, migrates in great numbers across the East African plains, and some 2 million of them move across the East African plains there. Not anything like that number here, but this is the same species, it's just a slightly different subspecies. And this, the one in East Africa, is called the brindled gnu, and this is just called the blue gnu. And if you've ever heard them call, you'll understand why. They look quite morose and they go, bow. 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 You can imagine if you went bow, and that was the only thing you could say, bow, then you too might be described as blue. Okay, on we go. Let us move along. They have gone into Biffle's Hook. We cannot follow them. Well, we wouldn't follow them off-road anyway, although, I mean, they're quite rare around here. Be worth following them off-road, I think, but they'd probably run away. We're going to head towards Biffle's Hook Dam now, see what we can find there, see if that female lion hasn't popped out there. And Dean, you want to know if the wildebeest is quite clued up on the gnus. No, there aren't any black wildebeest here. You find black wildebeest largely on the Highveld and in KwaZulu-Natal. They tend to higher lying areas with less woodland, I guess. I think ridiculous, given that we don't have the Kalahari and the fringes of the Kalahari Desert and up into Botswana, we probably have about 100 millimeters less rain than we do here. That is about 4 inches less rain than we do here, and they seem to thrive a bit better up there. They do mix, but they don't mix as in they don't interbreed, but there is a slight overlap in their range. A black wildebeest, everybody, a stunning animal with a bright white tail and a white mane. Similar looking to that, with the horns face slightly more forward as opposed to out to the side. Couldn't begin to tell you why that should be the case, but they are rather wonderful looking creatures, which we do not find here. It was a really nice surprise, that. So we'll head up over the hill here, down to the water's edge, see what we can find there. And if we don't find anything there, I'm tempted to just check if that lioness hasn't come back to where the cubs were yesterday. But I'll decide. I think they did check this morning and there was nothing there at all. We'll just have a quick look around Biffle's Hook Dam. She might be just lying there next to the water. Of course, things are getting dry now, and so you'll find more and more that what we'll do, unless we have a sighting like we do with Brent and those little leopards, we will be checking the water holes. We'll go from waterhole to waterhole as the dry season continues to become more and more severe. Just have a look here, everyone. A very important source of forage. And Davy, if we need to do a quick link, you'll tell me, will you? This is Albizia harveyi. I love these trees. I really think they're some of my favourites because they don't have thorns on them and so they don't do you any harm. And that means that you can climb them and you can sort of pick them and play with them without doing any damage to yourself. A massively important source of forage at the moment for the elephants. And you can see here, I say they don't do any harm, it doesn't stop me doing harm to myself. You can see here that they've chewed off a piece of the bark here. They've broken off a piece of the branch, and I suspect what they're going for is the cambium, but I've managed to, hang on a sec, here we go, let's see. Now we've sampled much cambium while we've been out here, and the best is the knobthorn by far. The cambium is the vascular layer, so the veins and things that grow underneath, here it is. That's where the water and the nutrients flow up from the roots and down from the leaves to the roots. David, I'm going to give you this to chew, because that is what the elephants like to eat. Thank see you. What you think. I'm just going to wait to see if he dies. What's it like, Dave?
It's actually quite sweet.
Oh, there we go. I'll try some. Mmm, it's not bad. The best is still, in fact, the red thorn, which is an acacia. And this is called a false thorn, or the common false thorn, because it looks like an acacia, but it isn't. And I don't know how it defends itself, but through chemical defenses in the leaves. It's really not bad. I might have to get my knife next time and cut off a larger piece. So that is Albizia harveyi, the false thorn or common false thorn. And it's sweetish. Not as distinctively tasteful as the other ones. Tastes like sweet wood, really, doesn't it? It's not bad. Very nice. Now that far end of the road there is our northeastern corner. We're not going to go quite that far. We're going to turn down south before we get there and go and see if we can't find something at the dam. It is a stunning afternoon, apparently 22 degrees Celsius, which is 73 degrees Fahrenheit. That's not very warm, and certainly when you drive a bit quickly, there is a little bit of a chill in the air, so we're still in winter, and this has been by far our coldest months. What on earth? Grief, I nearly had a heart attack. There's a diker there. Very nasty of you. Exploded out of the bush there. Now that it's given me a fright of my life, it's very relaxed. That's a really nice shot of a common diker. Goodbye. Do have a lovely afternoon. Wonderful. That's a really nice shot of a common dike, everybody. They're not large. Female, about 17 kilos. So he's a slightly lighter, and he's a he, of course, because he's got horns. What's he eating, Davy? Can you see? Well, at the moment, he's just cleaning himself of ectoparasites. Highly underrated is the diker. Now he's scratching his chin. I saw two of them having a fight the other day. Well, we all saw two of them having a fight the other day. And I think that they must be about to go into some form of breeding season. There, he's eating buds. Look at that. I mean, the flexibility is quite astounding. I just want to see what he eats. And often you hear people say, well, you know, diker eat meat as well. I don't think they eat a great deal of meat. Certainly there have been records of them eating guinea fowl chicks out of the nest, but they don't eat a great deal of meat. They probably do chew on bones, though, like many
of the antelope out here, especially at this time of the year. And Brent had a lovely sighting of some kudu eating some bones yesterday. He seems to have quite a lot of itchiness about him, David, don't you think? Maybe he was bitten by a mosquito. Astoundingly, despite the cool temperatures of the night time, I have been assailed by mosquitoes this whole winter. And I find that bizarre. It's never happened to me before out here. Very nice. Dam's just down here. Let's go and have a look and see what's there. Now, the lioness yesterday, Brent reckoned, was coming straight back towards this area. She helped kill that buffalo. She ate her fill and she moved off, leaving three. Well, we don't know where the other one's gone. Probably also to feed her cubs. We know that there are three lactating females. There are only three there this morning at the buffalo carcass. And I suspect quite strongly, oh, there's some water buck indicating that the lion is not too close by here. But I suspect, and some impala, I suspect the reason they had to leave that carcass was because the hyenas chased them off sometime during the course of the day. They were certainly around there earlier, but there weren't enough of them. Jeepers, look at this one right there. Right here next to us, there's a cow being tremendously confiding. And the smell of them I love. It's just like a comforting wood fire with a bit of old saddle mixed in. This one, of course, very relaxed, chewing on a piece of grass thoughtfully as she considers what it is she's going to do this evening. Isn't that nice? You can see her heart-shaped nose. Completely relaxed around us. This is fantastic. I think that's amazing. David, I might have to take a photograph, if you couldn't believe it. She will no doubt run before the world's slowest wildlife photographer is able to take a photograph. Oh, come on, focus. I got everybody. Ah, yes. Well done. I'm complimenting myself. Did you hear that, David? You must always be kind to yourself. It's very important. Okay, yes, look here again. Hello? Hello? She can hear another vehicle. That's why she's not looking this way. I love that grass hanging from her nose. I think that's too wonderful. No. Where are you going? I've got one, Dave. Thanks. The other thing it reminds me, the smell of, I don't know how many of you are, how many of you like to drink fine malt whiskey every so often, of course only on celebratory occasions, but a fine malt whiskey called Peat Monster. It smells like that sort of leathery, smoky, peaty smell. That's what a waterbuck smells like. Marvellous. Let's go across to Jamie, get an update from her. I'll have a look down here at the water.
Our update for you at the moment is that this is where a Karula, or around where Karula was last seen. And of course the leopards of this area absolutely love these big termite mounds that they can climb up, and they're doing exactly what I'm doing now, which is giving myself a little bit of an advantage of height, and also worrying slightly that Jandre is going to go tumbling down as he attempts to climb quite a crumbly termite mound. But what it does is it gives us a great perspective and a great viewpoint to look across. Now, I'm doing it for a different reason. I'm doing it because I'm looking for Karula. Herbert, I think, has picked up on her tracks, though, a little bit further to the south. But Karula would be doing it, or Mvula or Tingana, whichever leopard it is that we happen to be seeing. They would be doing it because here's the perfect place to spot prey. And that's what Karula was doing this morning. She was looking to see if she couldn't find something to eat. I'm going to attempt a descent now. It's going to be relatively tricky. I might fall down. and you can all have a jolly good giggle as I go tumbling down the termite mound. It's going to be fast. I think it's the only way forward. Here we go. It was slightly more graceful than I expected it to be. Sorry, everybody, if you were waiting for a spectacular fall on live TV. I'm afraid today I'm not providing one. It'll happen again. It's been too long since I last fell down. It's going to happen at some point soon in the not-too-distant future. And now, we're getting into the tricky area. This is the strychnos plants that we often talk about, the thickets. Now, they're bush encroacher species. What that means is that they grow up in clumps all around disturbed areas. And this is fine. This is pretty easy to manage. There's a couple of them every now and again. And in a couple of places in this reserve and in other places, they grow up to taller than I am. I'm about 5'7". They grow taller than that. And they basically form an impenetrable wall of vegetation. And if you lose a leopard or lion in there, chances are you're going to struggle to find them again. We're looking very carefully in this area. This place is crisscrossed with game paths. Clear, very clear paths where the animals have walked down them, basically making their own, the equivalent of a hiking trail. And we're checking each and every one really carefully to see if we don't spot Karula's tracks. I'm going to go see what Herbert's found. In the meantime, let's go back to Brent.
Yeah. In a really thick, thick area, they've gone down into that little river system. Our signal's a bit unstable. I'm going to start.
Hello, everybody. We're just going to see into the area where the lion cubs last were, and we're not going to sort of stick our noses too much around there. We're just going to look if the female is there, and if she is, well, then we might be lucky. If she isn't, well, then we won't be. And then we're going to go back to the dam. We did go and look at the dam. There are quite a few buffalo there. They are not going anywhere. There's also a hippopotamus. He's not going anywhere. The terrapin that was on his back might go for a swim, but I'm sure will go on to his little warming island shortly. Some arrow marked babblers there. There we go. I don't want to dally too long here, but there they are. Also been in much evidence of late, and they're certainly not preparing for the breeding season yet, but probably much like the buffalo, you know, they probably concentrate their flocks together in bird feeding parties because, well, it's difficult to find enough to eat out here at the moment. There we go. Right, now apparently Brent Leo Smith is going back to the Democratic Republic of the Congo, which is where we live, because the signal on Wendy is utterly abominable today. So at least we have pajamas out on foot. Mercifully not in her pajamas, of course. That would be slightly awkward, wouldn't it, David? Yes. Having an antelope-like girl wandering about the bushes in her flannel pajamas. Maybe we should do a pajama drive one day, David. Everybody, you can wear your long johns, which I saw you in today. Shocking, shocking thought. Do Dean and Nelspruit, nice question from you. You say, is it true that common dikers have got mates for life? Dean, I suspect quite strongly what you'll find is that they don't mate for life so much as they are monogamous. Now, that might sound like semantics, but it isn't. What it means is that they are monogamous to start with, and then they probably have a pair bond for a while that then breaks up, and they may well move on, especially if there happens to be sort of a death of one partner. They will almost certainly move on to be, to find other lovers, if you like. Well, there she is. She's there with the cubs. Oh, she's right down here, Davy. I'm afraid the view's not good, but she's right there. You see her there, Dave?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, if you just change the light there, you will see her. Sorry, everybody. I mean, I know it's difficult, and I will try and move, but there is a lioness there with very, very small cubs. And because she's here, we can spend a little bit of time here. I'm just going to back up a little bit, Dave. We'll see if you can get... You know, there you've got the lioness. And there you can see a tiny little cub, too. Sorry, I'm going to try and be manly about this. This is wonderful. Look how little. Its little ears don't even stand up yet. I'm just going to call this in. Everyone, we're not going to be here for long. It will only be a one-vehicle sighting. But there is a tiny little lion cub. Bernie, come in. Look at that. Bernie, do you copy Bernie? Now, Bernie, the mother is on site here, and also three youngsters. So I think we must make it a one-vehicle sighting. There's a 1 out of 5 visual. Look, it's yawning, it's so tired. If you give me just 5 minutes, then I'll pull up from here. Stations 1 and Kahuma Lioness on site with three cubs on the position to the north and east of Bivelshoek Dam. Best approach off the firebreak. You'll get a view from there. I think definitely a one-vehicle sighting. Isn't that wonderful, everybody? I'm just going to try and reposition slightly. This is fantastic. I can't believe this. I really thought this was a complete waste of time to come in here. And yet here we are. Davey, tell me if you get a decent view here. Oh, look at that. Sorry. There, Dave. Come back a bit. That way a little. There, in that gap there you are. Try there. There you are. No, that's a piece of sand, David. I can see them quite nicely. She's just, yeah. There, that's it. I think you've, no, you don't. Where's the camera pointing? You see the lioness? There's the lioness, but the cub is just to the left of her. There we go. That's her. There we are. Look, little things. They're only about 8 days old. Well, no, I'd say about probably 10 days old. So they're not old at all, obviously. Their little ears don't stand up yet. Davey, if I go forward, would that help you? Or back?
Backwards.
I'm just going to go... Yeah? You're right there. Just going to go back slightly. Very slightly. How's that, Dave? Beard, you say acuteness overload yet again. Yes, absolutely. I mean, this is just astounding. Oh, look at the little hairs in their ears. Are so small. They're not even making any noise yet. And the mother is being so very kind in letting us sit here and look at them. She wouldn't be so kind if we came in on foot. In fact, she'd be utterly terrifying. Just stunning stuff. There's the mother. This is wonderful. Stunning. There we go. Now, obviously, much too early to try and sex these little ones. But they too, so we saw the three today at the kill site. Go ahead, Bernie. Sorry, I'm just on the radio, everybody. Isn't that lovely? So those little ones that were at the kill today will suckle from this female that's got these little ones. There'll be no, they'll cross-suckle completely, which is amazing. Okay, copy that. And Janie, you say, are their eyes open? They are open. And their eyes open around about 6 days. All right, everyone. I think we're going to have... I'm just going to roll forward slightly. And then I am afraid we're going to have to move out of here. Try one more there, Dave, and then I think we're going to leave them be. She's completely relaxed there. Anyway, we know they're fine, so let's pull out of here. And I just, you know what, give me 1 second. Lou, I wonder if we could go to Jamie briefly. Just let me try and deal with the radio quickly, and let me find out if we can stay here. And then I'll let you know. Is that possible? Okay, let's go across the bushwalk, find out what Jamie's got. I'll just get an idea of what's going on here.
So guys, we've been having some amazing tracking lessons from Herbert, who works at the speed of light in order to follow tracks. It's amazing what hours and hours and hours out here will do for improving one's tracking skills. So this is what we're looking at. Now often when we stop to point at a track, we pointed a track on a road, in a nice patch of soft sand. Look at how indistinct these footprints are that we are following, and this is the sort of thing that we do off-road. We do it, not off-road, when we're off the vehicle, when we're trying to follow up on the animal. Now, we usually do it incredibly slowly. Herbert bounces from track to track to track to track. Already his mind is working several steps ahead of him. But this track for you guys must be next to impossible for you to see. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to outline what it is you're looking at. This is her lobe here, the back lobe, and this is, you can see two of the three toes. No, you can actually see three of the four toes, sorry. Leopards have four toes that they leave in their track. It's her foot going this way. But it is so, so difficult to see. The rest of the track would be sort of here. This would be the rest of the track. It's difficult to show you because the soil is incredibly difficult, and it is actually a fresh track. It's a fresh track from today, we know, because we left her there. on the Termite Mountain. We've probably tracked her about 50 metres or so. And if I put my foot next to Karula's track, you can see how indistinct parts of even my track, and I'm, well, I suppose Karula and I are probably close to the same weight. And now we've got the next step, which is whether she's gone onto the Termite Mound or whether she's gone to the Marula tree to scent mark. Did she go to the tree? Perfect. Herbert is nodding at me. Basically, what Herbert says to me is when you're tracking, you don't go now. You know where this track's going. You're not going to go step by step by step looking for each track. You're going to go one of two ways and check and see whether there's any sign of her here. And so if we follow along to Herbert, he's giving us a big grin. Oh, watch the holes, Jean-André. Please don't break another foot. Once is enough. Now look at this. Look at what Herbert's found. And see if you can see what Herbert's found, because I can barely see what Herbert's found. Is there a track there?
No. This is the backside.
This toe?
No.
No, this backside here. Oh, there's the toe.
The three loops, and here's the toe, the second, the third, and the fourth might be somewhere.
So right.
The next tracks are here.
How's that? How incredible is that? So that's, I'm standing on her next track because that's how difficult it is for them to see. And this track here, so what Herbert is telling us is this track, there's a track here. And the lobes are here, so the back of her foot is here. Oh, that was a bit exaggerated, sorry. And her toes are here. That's right, Herbert? Yeah. Yeah. I can barely see it from my perspective. I can sort of see it. And it just goes to show you what an art this is, because as Steph describes it, when a leopard walks over soil like this, it's like a piece of tissue paper blowing over the road. They barely leave a footprint behind. Her other track is here. Look at that. You see it? Do you all see it? You all swear blind that you see it? Because I don't see it from this angle. Do you see it, Jean-André? It's incredible. The art of tracking. And she probably came and scent marked here. Herbert is calling us on. He wants us to hurry up. He cannot understand why we can't get this tracking thing right. We're going to follow him. In the meantime, back to James and those amazing little lion cubs.
No one else wants to come here, everybody. So we're going to sit here for another 10 minutes and then we're going to pull out of here. Now, just to reiterate, I know that there are questions about sensitivity in this area. I think it's important just to go through the rules for why we are limit these sightings. First of all, the noise and the smell of vehicles mean that should there be a threat from another predator, like a marauding male, but most likely a hyena or even a leopard, they need to be able to hear and smell what's going on. With the mother here, that's obviously much easier. She's used to vehicles, she's the dominant predator. There is no chance that any hyena on its own is going to approach her. Look at the little thing. That's just unbelievable. And that's why we make it a one vehicle sighting. If they were here on their own, we wouldn't be viewing them. We did have a brief look here the other day when we thought they were the older cubs, but they weren't, they were just these little ones. Isn't that wonderful? I can't believe this. Oof. With the little blue eyes, which are going to change colour so very soon. Keep headbutting the side of the drainage line there. Now somewhere around this reserve or on Arethusa, there's another lioness, probably with cubs about this age too. Now three is not a big litter. It wouldn't be unusual for them to lose some cubs, but you know, these have just been born, so I'm assuming that they're okay. There's one there, there's one behind her, and I think there's another one. You can just see the spot sticking out the back there. What is that? Is that a cub? It is definitely a little cub. So she came back, she ate her fill of that buffalo and she came straight back here. And because of that, I think they were probably unable to defend the cubs, at least the kill. Oh, this is just unbelievable. I mean, I cannot believe we're having this sighting. Just 10 minutes we'll spend here, and then we'll head out. Everyone, this is rare. This is not a common sighting. We are very, very lucky indeed. Hello, Liz. You want to know how many cubs there are on the Nkuhuma Pride? How many confirmed cubs? Liz, you're absolutely correct. The first time round, it is six confirmed with this litter. That's exactly what it is. We don't know about the others. We just know that there's another lactating female. I can't even get a picture of them. Oh, that's too sweet. It's such a tiny little thing. We are so lucky, everyone. Anyway, I can't believe no one else wants to come and see them. I think it's wonderful. I think it's great for them. Because it's not us being here that's, you know, that might pose them a risk. It's the vehicles coming in and out that is an issue. Or can be an issue, isn't always. This is just too great. Now, Romy, you make a very good point. You say, how come we can visit tiny lion cubs? But the leopard cubs, their area was blocked off. Why is that? Romy, with lions, remember lions can defend their cubs. Lions are big. Nothing else is going to come past here and challenge that lion unless it's quite a lot of hyenas. So that's one of the main reasons. The other reason is, I mean, if there were tiny leopard cubs here and the mother was here, we'd consider looking at them depending on the sensitivity of the sighting. And there is, we do make kind of blanket rules. And those blanket rules are because there are lots of different people around here with different operating procedures. And that's a good thing. So it's a good thing that we make the different rules, at least the blanket rules. But for lions, because they are so much more dominant, and we're having no effect on them at all just by sitting here, we can be pretty confident that we're not affecting them. With leopards, because they aren't dominant, because they are dominated by lions and hyenas and even wild dogs to a certain extent, we just tend to leave them alone. They seem to be a lot more sensitive. You know, a single hyena coming along here would have its pipes cleaned for it, as it were. So tired. Isn't that beautiful? And Douglas, you're in Arizona and you say, would the mother carry these cubs to a new den site? Or would she, would they walk yet? No, I think they're at the age where they'd still carry him. She'd still carry them. They're very, very little. That cub, everyone, is, what, Dave, about maybe a foot long from tip to tail? But just getting to the age where they'll start to move with mum. Oh, wow. And B. Wilson, you say, have the cubs got their little milk teeth yet? Just about. just about. I can just see the little teeth sticking out there, but not much. They will have erupted by now. They're not born with teeth, though. Beautiful. Okay, everyone, I think we're going to call it now. That little cub has gone to sleep. Let's move out of here. I don't want to disturb them, obviously. So let's get out of here, and we'll leave them be with their mum here. And we'll go to Buffelshoek Dam and see what we can find there. Isn't that sweet? Beautiful. Well done, David. That wasn't too awful, was it?
Not at all.
Right. All right, let's quickly go across to Jamie and get an update while we ease our way out of the sighting. Just too fantastic for words.
An amazing time with James and those tiny, tiny little lion cubs. And we've got cub prints of a different kind here. And Herbert and I are trying to puzzle out exactly what went on here. There's a beautiful spot for leopards just on that termite mound with an enormous brown ivory tree, which is where little leopard cubs would love to play. And then, if we have a look here, there are tracks here, tiny tracks that even I can see. Tiny, tiny little tracks of a baby big cat. In this case, a leopard cub. Now, you can just see, I'm going to try and highlight for you. This is the front foot here. Compared to the size of mom's tracks, this is the front foot. This is the back foot, always longer and slightly thinner in big cats, or at least in our leopards and our lions. But look at the size of them. So they're coming this way, those are little toes, but look at the size of them compared to my hand. It's about the size of my index finger, the size of that cub track, or just a little bit less. So it's a baby. It's a baby leopard. That being said, we're not 100% sure that these tracks belong to Karula and her cubs. In fact, we think this might have been Shadow. Shadow and her little cubs, so Karula's daughter, for those of you who are unfamiliar with our different leopards, Karula's nearly 10-year-old daughter, has a cub of just a month younger than Karula's cubs, just off to the west of us. And this is their boundary. This is their territorial boundary. This line here, Zoe's Road and just a bit beyond. Shadow came out of our property with Brent and moved west onto Arethusa, so just outside of our traverse area. So, I think, and the tracks are all over here, up towards the termite mound all around, I think Shadow was playing somewhere here with her little cub, and I think this is where she's been hiding it. And perhaps, because our leopards have a very clever way of avoiding each other, perhaps that's why Karula was all the way towards Leadwood when she was last seen, and she went into Torchwood, and now she's come back, now that Shadow's moved off again. Now, the territorial boundary, even though they're mother and daughter, is there, and they'll growl at each other a little bit, and they'll be a bit unpleasant with each other. In Karula's case, she might even blow a spit bubble. This is a sighting that Brent actually had, where Karula blew a spit bubble at Shadow, just to show her displeasure. But they're not really tolerant. They're not going to fight, but they're not happy about the idea of the other in their company. Herbert's telling me, this way. He's found tracks going this way. It's incredible. Now, of course, Shadow might have left her cub here at some point and then gone off hunting and then gone to call her leopard cub with that incredible sort of... No, that was a terrible leopard cub impression. It's a sort of a deep chuffing sound. That was a very, very poor one. Perhaps we need to employ Brian to be our professional animal noise imitators. But they do call. And Ashley in Missouri was wondering how far a female leopard could hear her cub, or how far a leopard cub could hear mom. And if I have to guess, I don't know exactly, and I don't think anybody knows exactly how far that sound travels for, or at least how far that leopard cub can pick up on that sound. Just want to see what's over there. got something. Oh, cool. So actually, if I had to guess, I'd say probably just under a mile or so. Maybe a little bit further on a cold day. We're being watched, guys. We've been spotted. We've been spotted by something stripy. A whole herd of zebra. Now, obviously, usually our approach with animals on bushwalk is to try and not be seen, but I've been prattling away on my approach out here, so they knew I was there, they knew we were there from a long way back. So now what they're doing is they're quite comfortable with our distance because we're actually quite far away from them. We're probably about 200 or so yards, less than 150 or so yards from our zebra herd. The one that's uncomfortable, there's a little foal that is off to the left and away from the rest of the herd. That little chap is a bit more uncomfortable. He's probably going to go following behind. But other than that, they have relaxed completely. And we're constantly reading animals' body language and body behavior. It's a very, very important aspect of what we do. And a big giveaway when something is actually relaxed is if it bends down and starts feeding, chances are it's not terrified of you. That being said, you've got to watch out for elephants because sometimes they actually pretend to feed to trick you into thinking they're relaxed. But these guys are perfectly happy. They're alert. They're aware of us. They're watching us with ears forward. But at the moment, we're not displaying any kind of predatory behavior. Now, if I were to creep around the edges really softly and try and hide in the bushes and sneak up closer, or if I were to walk in a straight line towards them, then immediately that changes the way that I'm behaving and I become something scary. Now, if we wanted to get a little bit closer to them, we maybe could, but what we need to do is change our outline. So this upright stance, this two-legged upright stance that animals have over thousands of years of evolution learned to fear, can actually be broken. And I've done this before with an elephant, and I would hesitate to do it again. It was a very unique situation, but I've done it with an elephant before, where dropping down onto your haunches and making yourself less threatening often is a way of encouraging animals to be more relaxed around you. So if they wanted to come here, if we dropped down onto our haunches, maybe just sat and let them approach, it might be a very different story to trying to creep up closer. Hello, Zebbies. Keeping a close eye on their surroundings. They now are not even looking back at us. Looking off into the distance. Oh, somebody's going to get a kick. They might not be troubled by us, but sometimes they do get into each other's space and they become distinctly disgruntled. Right, we're going to leave our zebra and start heading towards home since we've managed to get as far away as we can possibly get. And it is eventually going to get dark. So it's time for us to change our direction. While we do that, let's go across to James, who, after his marvellous cub excitement, has gone across to Biffles Hook Dam to regain his composure.
Now we're just trying to ease down here because we'll get a really nice view if we can get to sort of eye level, because this section here of Biffles Hook Dam, which will shortly be inundated when the deluge begins, the section of the dam is at eye level with that hippo and with those buffalo. And this is going to be a lovely shot. How's that, Davey? Is that all right? You notice how I turned you towards the hippo? Yeah, so that if it takes displeasure at us. There are water buck here, there are buffalo at eye level. It's a wonderful sighting. I've got 74 radios, all of them tangled with each other. There we go, sorted that problem out. You'll be all pleased to know, because I know you were worried about that. And we now have one. How many buffalo have we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 beefies. Bob, the bachelor of Biffles Hook, he's here. Gracie, I hope you're watching. If you are watching, Bob sends his very best to you. He hopes you're feeling well and that you enjoyed seeing those little cubbies. There he is. This is wonderful. Isn't that great? Eye level with the hippopotamus. Can I do a lion face?
Oh no! It seems as though we have lost James. Brent is back at DRC, and thus you find yourself on a bushwalk that is limited by the amount of light that we have. Oh well, we'll have to deal with it, and we'll have to just carry on and see what we can see. Let me try and find you something out of the blue. Wait, I know what we can show you. I saw them on the road. We'll do a track for you. Let me see if I can't figure out exactly where they may be. Somewhere here there is a set of very interesting tracks. Where did they go? Now we have made our way back onto the road just because it is a bit faster for us to move in this way back to where we need to be, back towards quarantine, so that we can finish off our sunset walk, which is apparently what this is turning into, finish off our sunset walk somewhere close to quarantine. Aha! I've got a track for you. You got wild dogs. Oh wow, that's incredible. Let's go see the wild dog tracks. Ah, very, very cool. Now, Herbert has circled and provided us with direction as well. These are old wild dog tracks. These are, I think, when did James have the wild dogs? They must have cut through here a couple of days ago. But this is the wild dog track that Herbert has been pointing out to us. It's going to be tricky. Can you see it in this light, Chandra? This is the back foot of the dog. Now, compared to hyenas, they also have two lobes at the back, like a hyena track. But the tracks are much straighter, much less angular, and there's a slight gap between the toes and the back pad. Our dog, whoopsie, that dog's got 5 feet. Dogs only have 4 feet. 4 toes. That's the back foot, and the front foot is here. There we go. Wild dog tracks racing across the road. And then the other thing that I was going to show you was a little bit further ahead. It's a very mean track quiz. That will do it for you. Those of you, I think I've done this track quiz before. I don't want to make life too easy for you. But just have a look here. Can we see this track here, Gendre? This sweeping track that's been made along the road. I have asked this track quiz before. So perhaps it might just be easier for me to show you, because otherwise I think the people that have seen it will know almost straight away. This track made by grass blowing in the wind and actually creating a sweeping track that most people think was made by elephants or something similar. Wonderful news. It seems as though James is back up and running. Let's go across to him, find out what he's found.
Right, here we are. Sorry, we don't know what happened there. We've got absolutely no idea whatsoever. Anyway, here we are. And we're back sitting with our beefies, with Bob, who has decided to get onto his knees. He's eyeing us. And I think you might find that lioness comes down to have a drink later on towards the end. Oh, maybe I'll do that for you. You see that, David? That's called the Flemen Grimace. Is that the one, Gracie? If it wasn't, make another one. Let's go back to the animals, David. There's also a grey heron sitting on the left-hand side of this little water hole. And all is marvellously peaceful here. There he is, just surveying the place to see if there might be a fish or two to eat. And every day, this water gets slightly less. And Bob, the bachelor of Biffle's Hook, has slightly less water covering his body, which at this time of the year is not a train smash, but as it begins to get really dry during the September months, oof. Wendy, you want to know how quickly that hippopotamus could get out of the water if he was to take displeasure to us. Very fast, Wendy. He would be between there and here. We're probably, what, about 20 metres away, Dave?
Yep.
20 metres? 20 metres, so that's about 70 feet. He would be here within 3 seconds, I'm at 4 seconds if he wanted to. There's quite a lot of mud, call it 5 seconds. They're very fast.
22 metres.
The reason I'm not particularly worried about us, we are in a vehicle and he's not big enough to turn the vehicle over. He seems to be kind of rising to the challenge there, Dave, don't you think? Yeah. That's also why, of course, I faced David towards the hippopotamus.
Thanks, James.
Yeah, I do what I can for you, Davey. He's watching us, but he's not, you know, the last time we came down here, he got out of the water a little bit, and that's not very nice to him. At the moment, I don't think he's particularly worried. He's just eyeing us out a bit, so I don't feel we're being completely insensitive to him. And he is kind of nodding off there. He's kind of going to sleep. But just watch how long... They, you know, we often asked how long a hippo can stay under the water. Now, although he's not under the water, you can see that his nose has been under the water now for at least a minute. So he has not breathed air for at least a minute, which I think is quite impressive. And we're told that they're able to do it for 8 minutes. I've never seen that before. Never seen. I know he's doing a job there. He'll have a breath now. I'm not very comfortable with you. I don't think it's a prelude to any kind of attack, but he is just giving us a little bit of a statement. And so I think we've had a really nice view here. And I don't want to be nasty to him, Dave. I'm just going to ask you to quickly look at that buffalo that's standing broadside to us. There are three little oxpeckers perfectly perched on his... Three little red-billed oxpeckers. All right. We're apparently our signal is also not good down here. So we're going to reposition. We're going to reverse back up this fairly substantial slope. Hold on, David. Don't topple out of the car. Could be a nasty, nasty experience. Not so much the toppling, but the result thereof. There we are. That's quite a slope, that. We won't be able to do that for long, of course, because when the deluge does come, that will be inundated and there'll be water everywhere. Rusty did very well to maintain signal there. We're quite a long way from the tower. Hello, Eileen. You're in London and you say, what's the reason that a hippo has got such a blubberous physique? Why such a fatty? Largely the same reason a whale is fatty, because they get cold in the water. You know that no matter how sort of aquatic a human being gets, if they're in the water for a substantial length of time, they're going to get cold. And it's very much the same with any other mammal, except those that are very specially adapted to being in water. And obviously a hippopotamus is very specially adapted to being in water, but it needs to have that covering of fat, otherwise they do get cold. Remember that in order for a mammal's body to function at optimal sort of temperatures, it's got to be sort of from, let me go to, I'm going to start that again, David. I'm starting to lose my mind. For a mammal to operate at optimal metabolic function, it needs to be at around 36 degrees Celsius, give or take a degree or two, or three in some cases. Now, the water here, no matter how hot it gets, you'll find that the water here will very seldom be anything less, especially in winter, it will seldom be anything more than 27, maybe 28 degrees Celsius. So, I'm not going to convert all of that into Fahrenheit, I'm just going to do it in Celsius for now. Which means that no matter how warm that water feels, it's always colder than the hippo is, which means it's inevitably, eventually going to cool the hippo down. And I'm not sure why it is, I suppose, that an outside air temperature doesn't cool you down in the same way that water does. But even the warmest water will cool you down to that temperature. And why they insulate themselves. Lovely here. Hello, Honey Bear in Connecticut. You are wondering about the hippo's skin and whether the sand has an effect on it because it can't submerge itself completely. To a certain extent, yes, Honey Bear. It hasn't been very hot. That does make a difference. The angle of the sun will make a difference. But you can see, if you look at the close-up of Bob's skin there, it's not too cracked, and it doesn't look like it's exuding that pink stuff that helps them to cope with the sun. In the summertime, that would not be the case. In the summertime, it would be a lot hotter. You'll find that skin much more cracked on the top there. You see where it's a little bit cracked there? It would be much more cracked. There'd probably be a fairly evil-smelling pink substance coming out of those cracks, trying to protect the hippo skin from the sun. So not too much of a train smasher this time of the year. Hello, Cassandra. You're wondering whether when a hippo is stressed, its skin turns red. No, Cassandra, that's not the case. Just hang on a second. Oh, its sweat turns red. No, that's not stress, it's heat. And it's not the sweat, that substance that they exude to protect their skin from the sun. I suppose it could be considered kind of sweat, but no, it's not because they are stressed that they produce that. They produce it when they're heat stressed, but not necessarily emotionally stressed. All right, everyone, I think we should move on from Beetle's Hook Dam and see what else we can find along the way. A very good call to come to the dam here, David. I think, yes, very nice. So we'll go and see what we can find. Brent Leo Smith is driving around trying to fix Wendy. Well, that's what I'm told. I think he's driving around, and I think Peter Bratt, who is on site, he's one of the directors, the technical director. I think he's trying to fix Wendy, and Brent is nobly driving about the place, seeing if he can get signal. Hopefully by the end of the drive, we'll have some signal with him. Righty, on we go, David. Marvellous sighting at Beetle's Hook Dam. Unfortunately, Beetle's Hook Dam not to have water in it for too much longer, alas and alack. I think it's going to last another... Dave, how long do you think?
10 days.
Dave reckons 10 days, everybody. I'm going to give it 3 weeks before we get the last little bit of water. Ah, good. Thank you, Gracie. You say that was the lion face you were looking for. And you say you're also very happy to have seen Bob. You say that sometimes he's on a timeout because he hasn't been very nice to the others. Yes, I'm not sure it's so much that, Gracie. You know, when men get old, when they get younger than me, when they turn about 18 or 19, well, they need to go and find themselves. And that's what Bob's doing. He's just gone off. He's left his family. He will one day hopefully have his own family. But in between that time, well, he's just got to find himself. He's got to make his way in the world. And that's what we men have to do. And likewise, the hippopotamus bulls as well. Ah, very good news, everyone. Brent Leo Smith, with his very fine kit of screwdrivers and excellent application for technical work, has managed to fix Wendy. Let's go and find out how he managed it.
Oh, of course, that is an absolute lie. The man with the screwdrivers and technical ability is Mr. Peter Bright, who's managed to fix whatever was wrong. And this is the exact spot we were driving when we went black screen earlier, but now here we are. So, as I was that sighting is now closed. We've zoned it completely. As Mom's not there and the sun is starting to sink a bit low in the sky. And I think I am going to go look for some elephants now. We did see a single elephant bull when we were having some tech difficulties. So I'm going to go see if we can catch up with that Ellie. He was at the Juma Dam cam, so maybe he's maneuvered through. Also, I think Brian and I are going to go do a quick scan of some of the hyena dens, see if there's any activity there. But it is a glorious winter's evening. Lovely reds and oranges at this time of the year. And of course we'll be on the lookout for any other creatures that might be out and about. You know, gorillas are knocking about somewhere. I think Tingana might be as well. So I think I'm going to slowly move towards the western areas and then come down south slowly. Oh, hello. What a large bottom appearing out of the bush. Hello, mister. I wonder if this is one of the buffalo bulls that the Inkahumas were hunting with Jamie a few drives ago. The right sort of area. You had some nice big congregations of these buffalo bulls on Juma. Now these guys aren't showing too much sign of the drought yet, but as we head deeper into the drought, we're going to start seeing their hip bones showing a little bit more and maybe some ribs. Now, the drought is a difficult time for the herbivores, but it's a great time to be a carnivore. And it's a great time to have baby carnivores. And I think we have an incredible amount of baby carnivores knocking about at the moment. And if we try to work it out, 6, 16, at least 22 cubs around at the moment, maybe one or two more once we find the Inkahumas, the third lioness who's got cubs. We've been looking at another buffalo bull for the last 2 days, but he is no longer breathing and was caught by the Inkahuma pride. And Don is wondering if those little Inkahuma cubs would have fed on the carcass or they're still too young. Donna, they would have fed, but not very much. They're still mostly reliant on milk, but they are able to digest meat already, so I'm pretty sure they would have snacked on some of that meat before they left. Now, I think the Nkumas have left that carcass, abandoned that carcass, because of the high number of hyenas in that area and those young cubs being there. They might go back. You never know. But I think another reason I want to check the south and west is because, you never know, those Nkumas might be on their way back from Sibambili. That's where they went to this morning. And so hopefully they'll be back on Juma in 2 ticks. You can see we're going right into the sun at the moment. Very bright. Ryan is looking through his sunglasses. Oh, hello. And the great survivor out here. And the great generalist is probably the best description, as they are able to eat both grass and leaves, and that enables them to be in quite a few different habitats and far more widespread and far less cornered into a certain habitat, the impala. But they're about to pop behind the termite mound. Oh, there's an Inyala bull at the back there as well. And there's some male impala. Now, we're going to leave these incredibly graceful animals and go across to another graceful animal who's on foot.
It's to draw in. The shadows are getting long, and that means it's time for us to start heading back towards the safety of quarantine. But before we do, I said the shadows are getting long. Jandre has come up with a brilliant idea. Jandre is going to join me in the best shadow dancing segment you've ever seen, just because we're having an absolute ball. I've been trying to make myself into the giraffe silhouette, like the one that we saw the other day, where there's an ossicone. Sort of looks like a giraffe. It doesn't look like a giraffe at all, does it? Maybe a brachiosaurus or something. Or a diplodocus. Here we go. Oh no, my hair ruined it. Hold on. No, my hair's ruined it completely. Stay there. Here we go. Going to be a giraffe. Like a silhouette going in the sunlight, since we don't have an actual giraffe to show you. And to start heading back to quarantine. Also, just something to show you while we do start marching back, Herbert's keeping us moving, is a giant land snail shell. Try and get it in the sun for you. And this is recent. This has been broken open and eaten recently by some kind of giant land snail predator that's come through. The reason I say that is it's still got all of its colouring. So it's that brown, it hasn't been bleached white by the sun out here. So just a little portion of a land snail shell, maybe a bird, maybe something like a mongoose or one of the cats, but I think it's most likely a bird species. Jandre's got a spider web dangling from his camera. It's a pleasure. Let us continue onwards, because our dancing shadows, first of all, they indicate that time is getting on, and second of all, they also indicate that we've gone completely mad. At this point, in our race to find Karula, Herbert is absolutely determined to figure out where she's gone. We have now scoured the block. She might possibly be on her way back towards the cubs. A little bit further back, we found a drag mark that Herbert picked up upon. A drag mark from a kill that he thinks she made and hyenas stole from her sometime in the not too distant past. You got a fly on your nose by any chance, Jandre? Jandre, I'm watching, I'm talking to you guys, but at the same time I've got Jandre going. And I've just seen why, because there's a fly in his face. There you go.
Thank you.
You never know with Jandre. He might be trying to make us laugh. He might also fall backwards at the speed he's going. It's amazing that Jandre hasn't actually injured himself more on bushwalk. This is the first time I've ever been out on bushwalk with Jandre as the cameraman. Now, you, most of you know, Jandre's now high-stepping in case, because he doesn't know what's behind him. So he's high-stepping because he's walking backwards. Most of you know, the cameramen have this enormous backpack with a giant antenna that sits upon their back, and then they've got the camera with them. So it's very, very heavy for a start. Second of all, they've got cables absolutely everywhere. And thirdly, they're busy focusing. This is all handheld camera work while he's walking backwards with a giant backpack and an antenna on his back. He's doing a marvelous job. Quite simply extraordinary. And he's very lucky we're on a road, or else he would have fallen down by now. Jean-André says now. We're going to head up to quarantine to find you the last few moments of our sunset safari over there. In the meantime, let's go across to James, find out what's happening.
One reason I'm laughing is because I'm afraid the audio gone. Okay. How about that, Dave? You can hear me now? You can hear me, good. Now, the reason I got off the car, I shan't tell you why I was laughing, it's rather disgusting. Well, not disgusting, it's just not pleasant. All around here, you can see that there is damage. Elephants have pushed over and created a great and mangled disasterville of knob thorns and groovier bushes and the odd cambretum bush and all sorts of others. And this might lead one to the conclusion, of course, that elephants are bad for the environment, because very clearly they have irrevocably changed this area. And if you look into this area in September, it'll look even worse, because there won't be any leaves left on any of those trees, and indeed the skyline, which is largely made up of knobthorn trees and one or two cambretum trees or bush willows, that will change. Elephants will have pushed a lot of those things over. So the question is, are elephants damaging this environment? And my answer is, no, they're not. They're changing it, absolutely. It's completely normal for a drought year like this for them to change an environment. And I just think there's no better place on this reserve to demonstrate the effect that they're having. A year ago, all of these trees here that have fallen on the ground were standing upright. They're all dead now. That's okay. They've created habitats for all sorts of other animals, invertebrates largely, of course, bugs and scorpions, those incredible sightings that Herbert and Steph find when they're on foot, and Jamie too today, largely a result of elephants pushing things over. There's a footman. There's a footman moth, everyone. Let me capture it. Hang on a second. A footman. We found them, a whole lot of them yet the other day. And they were crawling about on a gwari bush because the gwaris have started to bud. And these footmen are kind of winter moths. This one is going to have a nasty shock when I turn the engine on. Now, I don't think it's here. Let's see if it went inside for some warmth. No, nothing there except Rusty's engine. Anyway, the beautiful coloured moth, little white, orange and black spots. Very nice. And very unusual, of course, to find colour like that in the winter time. On we go, David. Let's go and see what we can find up on the crest here. I sort of came this way hoping to get a good sunset shot, which I think we will get. I don't think it's going to be the most amazing sunset because it's a very clear winter sky, but there's quite a lot of dust on the western horizon, so we might get a good one. Let's go and look. Not too far up the top of the hill here that we'll get a look. David's just putting on his skateboarding gloves. Cycling gloves, are they, David?
That's right.
Do you own a bicycle?
Yes.
You do? Where is it?
I'm not sure.
I used to own a bicycle, David. I don't anymore. There is a Nyala cow. And she's golden in the setting sun. And the reason we're zooming in on her slowly, of course, is because David hasn't put his skateboarding gloves on, his cycling gloves on yet. Stunning. Just keeping the flies and the ticks off the body there with that very furry little tail. There they are. And in the background, a white-browed scrub robin. Might even be a lark, you know. I think it could be a Sabota lark that's calling there. Right, I don't want to stop here for too long. I want to go up onto the top of the crest here and see if we can get a view of the setting sun. I know we've done it 100 times, but it's just so lovely. I have to work out how many drives I've taken. I've been here just over a year now. What do we say, about a quarter of the time off. It'd be fascinating to know how, when you get to milestones like 100 and 200 and 300. And as Louise says, I'm always welcome to go to the archives and check. Louise, I'm not that fascinated by it. But thank you. Thank you for the offer. If you're really kind, you'd do it for me, of course. Louise says she's got better things to do with her life. I think that's very unfair, Louise. Perhaps Jerry will do it for me. There's no ways Jerry will do it for me. It's just slightly early for the sunset at this stage, so we'll drive along here for a little while and see what we can find. In the meantime, let us go across to Brent Leo Smith and his fine set of screwdrivers and see what he's managed to find with them.
Well, screwdrivers are not very useful when looking for animals, and as you can see, the screwdrivers have produced nothing. But we are on our way towards Sydney's waterhole. I just want to have a quick look in that area. So I think the Nkuhumas might come back from the north, from the west. And also, Tingana does like to patrol this area, and Mvula was not too far away from here yesterday morning. So we're going to keep going, and I'm hoping to see something glorious in this late afternoon light. Brian is warming up. He's got his massive blanket. You could probably fit 4 people inside Brian's blanket, or just Brian. He looks quite warm. I'm a little jealous. And we're going to stop now up on the top here and have a quick look at the vast expanse that is the Lowveld area of South Africa. Now, it's called the Lowveld because it's not very high. So on average, you're probably looking between 400 and 500 meters above sea level. And that is quite low without being too low. And it's nestled between 2 mountain ranges. The Lubombo Mountains in the east and the Drakensberg Mountains in the west. Now, in a lot of the Lubombo Mountains, they look a bit more like foothills than mountains, but the Drakensberg is a very impressive and one of the longest mountain ranges in Africa. How's that, Brian? A little bit further. Let's get past the bush, will I? And we'll see, it's a great expanse. So even though the country is quite undulating, lots of little hills and valleys and dips. If you look at it from a point like this, it is relatively flat. So there we go. Let me look off into the distance. Here we go, you can see the Drakensberg just to the left of the sun. Oh, and the only 2 clouds I've seen all day. Now, you can see below the Drakensberg, you can see there's different undulations in that, although it is still relatively very flat. And it keeps on like that for the majority of the Lowveld. And isn't that spectacular? Now, I've just got a message from Jamie, and she said she's got very fresh tracks of Karula that could be heading towards the Juma Dam camp. So guys, keep a lookout, and I'm gonna start making my way there. So very, very fresh tracks. Jamie and we're gonna go back down there to have a look. We were quite close on Mvubu. We did check the Mvubu Road hyena den. Alas, no hyena souls were present. Wouldn't it be nice to see the queen in this golden light? It's nice to see the queen in any light, to be honest. For those who are wondering who the queen is, it is Queen Karula, the dominant female leopard of Juma. And we saw her two latest offspring, Shongile and Hosanna, this beginning of the sunset safari. So she leaves her cubs in a nice safe spot like that while she goes out to try hunt and catch them a meal. So hopefully she'll be successful. I've changed my mind about which route I want to take. I'm going to stick on this. Be finding out what they've done is they've kept people away from that area and they've popped up a camera trap. So and Tundi, how many cubs are there yet? Into the bush behind, so there the rest of the harem are here. Fingers crossed. Oh, sun has dipped. The temperature has some good camouflage. Look at that. See how it breaks up the outlines. Oh. Towards the trees, getting that light at the moment. And get my blankie out for my leg. And of course we're about to head east now down towards Vuyatela. So we're gonna be going away from the last
resting place we can't see, and as you saw yesterday
back, so let's go catch up with them before they head home.
Ms. Def, perhaps we should do our farewell to you. Thank you to Jandre. Walk out here. We don't want to encounter anything that might be heading to its pleasure. We'll catch up with you tomorrow morning on the Sunrise Safari. For now, farewell, and we will see you then. Enjoy the rest of kiss things out here, just in terms of physical strength and senses, and we certainly can't see at night. It's time for us to head home and make...
I think it's rather...
And we will see you then.
Enjoy... Obviously, days. And as that sunset goes, the sun dips below the horizon there. Let's just have a listen. Almost invisibly. At night, it doesn't really make a difference. I'm sorry. And see what we... I hope you didn't see that, everybody. Stick leopards, and whether we find them here, we don't find them here. I would imagine that no one should have to see that. I'm very quite... I think nocturnal pelage would be quite nice. Nocturnal when we think they are. Lions, not so much. Lions, especially as they get big, I think.
Might pop out there. Just want to check all these elephant paths, make sure there's no
trap. It would be quite nice to see something like that. So while we explore, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith and find out where they
said Kula's tracks were heading. We're just checking that she hasn't crossed this road. Keep an eye on the Juma Dam cam. She might pop out there. Just want to check all these elephants. Harder to spot. Make sure the track. Now in this twilight, she's going to be a little bit harder to spot up there in space. So. Remember, is playing a bit of havoc. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to the tech loop while the tech gurus
sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over. We'll be back with you as soon as we can. Everybody, perhaps Lee trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can. Pushed over the as soon as we can. Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gun. Rushing around madly trying to. Sorry about this, everybody.
And he brought it out to the bush, and then he gave it to me. That eventually is what we will be doing. Probably not so much with infrared, because the colour with it, and it's a bit like if you've seen him try and do it sensitively. He's on the hunt at night time, well, then they're excellent to have. Night for a reason, unless you're looking at, we don't very poor. You don't get
for Queen Karula. I think she's still hunting in this area somewhere. We're not going to...
Because it wants to be lit up.
With a spotting cold winter's eve. No, in a tree. I'm still off cold winter's evenings. It's quite chilly. A civet tour. Only answer to that. And of course, always checking for bush babies living in my life when I have... I will wear blankets and many, and I am definitely regretting my decision not to wear long pants now. Even with my only answer to them is it's tough being tough, and I'd rather be warm. That's all. So the direction cut back further south or west, but no luck so. So the tracks were in this area, but we mount. You have bush buck, beautiful. Would like to know, is any the Drakensberg in this, would you find living up there? Well, I've climbed some of them, bigger bush baby species, and right up to the sort of alpine top, and it's you have mountains. You actually get red duiker in some of the forests on the lower slopes. Leopard, jackal, and you can actually in the forest there's quite a lot of thick tail is ahead, so it's is stationed up on top of our way up. We did see Dean, we went up there, and Connor actually was also there when we went up there to put a new in. And up there there are, well, I drive around, I can show you one of my favorite beautiful of, don't move. Also very interesting birds up on the top there. You get incredible sunbirds, the malachite sunbird. There we go, look at that. Absolutely beautiful. So here we go. Look at that. Isn't it absolutely spectacular? That's a non-breeding male. A dull dun brown. And there's the female. And there's things which look very similar to the map.
Myself
on this western edge.
P
keep so
nice, but not tell everyone that I've done stage of the day that I must admit. That's quite a good idea. I might do that. Shong, you and David only, and Louise, yes, new name, but who's also in it, final. Maybe I could just, well, no. That. Except you, Louise and Chelsea. They're Clint, age 10, you've. You're as confused as we all are. You want to know why it is that the leopards' names have changed, and do they change all the time? They change just because Justin or Jerry depend names, and they're the names of the two youngest members of the British royal family. Brooke, the guides on the leopards, they picked Shongile and Hosanna, and so, well, that's what we're going to call them from now on in. So although I'm being a little bit facetious and depressed about the fact that my ridiculous names are not being kept, Shongile and Horsa myself, then you can do that. Otherwise,